Oh, okay.
Month of the year, I'll probably say.
Right.
Do like faces like Kevin does. Scare them away.
All right. We're going to kick it off with a couple songs if y'all want to stand up and join in. Great job. We got one more, so don't sit down just yet.
I gotta do it. 30 and 5.
No, put it on the clean channel.
Okay.
I'll have a full switch yet.
But when you take that jump, you don't fear the fall. Hope when the water rises, you build a wall. Hope in the crowd screams out, screaming your name. Hope if everybody runs, you choose to stay.
Down.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Welcome to Sunday Assembly. It's been too long. So Sunday Assembly is a secular congregation that celebrates life. We're born from nothing and go to nothing, so let's enjoy the time we have in between together. Sunday Assembly has no doctrine. We have no set text, so we can make use of wisdom from all sources. We have no deity. We don't do supernatural, but we won't tell you you're wrong if you do. Sunday Assembly is radically inclusive. Everyone is welcome, regardless of your beliefs. This is a place of love that is open and accepting. We won't tell you how to live, but we'll try to help you live as best as you can. Our motto is very simple: live better, help often, and wonder more. And our vision is to help everyone live life as fully as possible. So we're a community of people in the Triangle who are interested in celebrating the wonder of life and making the most of the one life we know we have. So we have a big assembly like this one on the second Sunday of every month. And we also have smaller events in between so that we can continue to build community. And Sunday Assembly Chapel Hill is part of a global movement. There are over 70 assemblies around the world. I'm really excited because I've noticed when I was at the table earlier that we've got a lot of new folks today. So this is a perfect day to do a people search. So Mandy's gonna hand out the people search. So for this icebreaker, we have to take a little bit of extra time, so we'll probably take about 10 minutes. And this is a way to get to know each other. So see how many squares you can fill. Try to find someone who meets the criteria of that square, and you can check it off, or you can have them sign it, however you'd like to do. There's a couple different versions of this, so not everyone is going to have the same grid. But we did this just about a year ago, and it was really, really fun. So, oh yeah, if you have a pen, and we've got some pencils, we've got some markers, I think we have some additional pens in the back. I'll go dig those out now.
Can you find why someone would be deeply offended by making use of dry erase markers?
Yeah. Anybody else need a pencil? Pencil? You need a pencil?
Hey Joe, you've been to a Sunday Assembly game day.
This is also a great time if you have a life happen. The life happens to go and share your news with us.
Thank you. swimming in the river.
Yes. So, Kevin, hi.
go. Let's go. Don't, no, I'm not a grandma. Everybody says, get her. She's probably a grandma.
The grandparents are
here?
I don't think anybody is here.
Surprised you what they could fill in. Raise your hand if you found somebody you were really surprised by their answer. Get a few people. Cool. Awesome. I hope we all, there's some things on there. Has anyone here been to Alaska or was that an impossible? Look at that. See, there's always someone. Who here has written a book? Do we have any authors? Anyone who's written a book? There we go. Sue's got a book. We've got some folks.
We can. Fingernails.
Oh, does anyone have painted fingernails today?
Not today.
Yeah, that was a surprisingly tricky one. Great. Just two real quick announcements before we do our moment of science with Jake. One is that we've got kids' activities going on in the back, so if any kids are interested, you can sort of go back, come forward. We're very casual here with the kids' activities. The other thing is that we do Life Happens. Stage dive. We do this thing called Life Happens every month, where you can share anonymously or not, just something good or something not so good, something challenging you might be going through, and we read those cards. So if you have a Life Happens, something you want to share with the community, we've got the blue basket up at the table, and there's note cards, and feel free to head over anytime and fill one of those out. We would love to hear your news. And now I'm going to hand it over to Jake.
Hi everybody. So, as some of you know, my background, if you will, for science is I'm a PhD student at North Carolina University in plant biology, and I actually research algae. So, for once, I'm talking about something I know a little bit more about, I guess. So, I just wanted to talk to you guys a little about algae because I find them very interesting, and then I wanted to talk to you about a specific algae because it's like one of those oddballs that people are like, what? So they're kind of fun. So algae, I always think of as these extremely small organisms, but they make a huge difference. So you can kind of see, looking at the pictures, all of those are different algae. There's an amazing diversity in shapes, sizes, morphologies, colors, kind of thing. The things they do, how they react to different situations, the locations that they can be found in. You can find algae pretty much anywhere. I can guarantee you it's floating in the air right now, too. Even though most people view it as like being, you know, contained, like in the water, like you can find it almost anywhere. So these are organisms that make a huge difference in our world, primarily because they're a huge source of fixing carbon dioxide, converting it into oxygen that we need to breathe, which is, you know, kind of important. I wanted to talk to you specifically about snow algae, though, which most people would think is very strange because, you know, it's frozen water, not a whole lot of things move or do anything when it's frozen, especially because plants usually don't create their own heat. So it's not like us where we can survive in snow because we're creating our own heat. Plants usually don't do that. So there are different, there are some algae out there, and just kind of as a raise of hands, has anybody ever seen snow algae? Like, have you seen snow that's been kind of like covered in this like red sheen? Oh, that's awesome. So I'm from northern Wisconsin, and I unfortunately have never seen this. I think it'd be really cool. But they're called stuff like, wow, okay. pink snow, watermelon snow, red snow, blood snow, if you know, whatever. So you can see they're kind of these red organisms. They're like very weirdly shaped. And I kind of like these because they're actually closely related to the algae I work on. But mine are usually found in the ocean. These you can find on snowbanks. And they're usually found even at higher latitudes in a lot of cases. Like you'll find stuff like this in the Arctic, the Antarctic. And so they're algae that can actually survive on snow. They actually create their own like little water pockets. For their own use. And the reason they can do this is because they're colored. So you see they have that red color. If you're from the north, you know that people will a lot of time use sand and gravel to melt snow. And that's because it absorbs heat energy from the sun much better and then radiates it out, melts the snow around it, snow, ice, whatever. So these algae kind of function very much in the same way. So they create this color, they form this little pocket in which they can survive. They're very slow, it's not like they're like swimming around in it, it's only a little bit of water. But they're able to thrive in a location that you would normally think of as pretty sterile and dead kind of thing, which I always think is cool. So, and they have some interesting impacts, you could say, on the climate. So one of the researchers, what they found, is some of the things we know about them as usual. They absorb CO2, produce oxygen, they decrease greenhouse gas. This is something we just need to create and maintain, this CO2-oxygen cycle we have on the Earth. One of the cool things they found is that recent research shows that they might actually be able to contribute to climate change, because as the planet warms, it's easier for them to establish themselves, and the more algae that can grow in these snowy areas and in glaciers will cause increased melting. And that's because of that color that they form. The more of it's there, the more melting happens, and that just kind of like builds on itself. So researchers found that they add up to like, so they're not increasing it like a lot, so like it's not like a panic inducing thing. So like, this isn't one of those like plants are taking over the world thing, although, they're kind of nice. But what they found is they can actually cause like a 13% acceleration increase in kind of like the melting snow where they're located. So they're not found everywhere. But this is just kind of like, I like to think of it as like a pretty yet destructive kind of thing. Like, we see them, they're cute, but, and yet they can have this like huge impact that you might think is like very small, but it actually radiates outward. And I think of that as for like a lot of small organisms. Mostly because the plant I work on is microscopic, so it's not like adorable, you can't really touch it or handle it, but like it's small, and in its smallness it can do a lot of unique things. It can also have like a huge impact on everything around it, and I think that's really true of like algae in general, bacteria, everything, and people, if you want to think of it that way. Like, we can all have our own. So that's really all I have. But I don't know, do we want to take any questions? Did I have a time limit? So algae is actually a very interesting term. It actually encompasses eukaryotic, or it actually encompasses both bacterial and eukaryotic organisms. It's a catch-all term basically for anything that is single-celled and yet photosynthetic. So anything that uses light energy to create energy. Yeah, light to create energy. So I personally don't actually like it as a term because it's not hyper-specific, and I'm a scientist and I like specificity, but I realize it's useful as a term. This one specifically is in the plant lineage, though. This would be considered a plant.
So just to confirm that, even only in different places where there's snow all year round?
So they thrive where there is snow all year long. Just because they can basically outcompete everything else around them, you can find them in other areas. They just don't compete as well. That can be considered pretty common, especially in the microbial world. You'll see places where a single organism dominates, but they'll also be present in like very low concentrations in other places that are actually more optimal for them to grow. Like, these don't actually want to grow on snow. They would prefer to grow like in a nice environment, but they have the means with which to survive here, whereas a lot of other things don't, which is why you see them emphasized here. But like, you could probably find them in ponds in this area, but they're used to competing on this level, but those scales aren't very useful in North Carolina, specifically Wisconsin more so, but yeah, not so much here. So they can be found in a lot of locations, but yeah. I'll be around if anyone has other questions.
Hi, okay,
so I'm going to introduce our speaker today. Nicole's been a member of Sunday Assembly Chapel Hill since the beginning. In addition to working full-time as an accountant, going to nursing school part-time, and running half marathons, she's also on our organizing team. And if she didn't have bronchitis, she also would have been singing in the band today. Even though I keep making stupid faces at her every time we practice, I haven't been able to drive her away yet. But today she's here as our speaker. She's going to share some wisdom she's gained as a professional doer of all the things. So please welcome Nicole Feinecker.
Thank you, Kevin.
all of you. Everyone named Kevin, thank you. Okay, so I'm going to start today with a little story from the Mexican fisherman. I've seen it many places around the web. I don't know specifically who to attribute it to, but I definitely didn't write it. An American investment banker was at a pier of a small coastal Mexican village when a small boat with just one fisherman docked. Inside the small boat were several large yellowfin tuna. The American complimented the Mexican on the quality of his fish and asked how long it took to catch them. Only a little while. The American then asked why didn't he stay out longer and catch more fish. The Mexican said he had enough to support his family's immediate needs. And the American asked, but why, what do you do with the rest of your time? The fisherman said, I sleep late, fish a little, play with my children, take siestas with my wife, stroll into the village each evening where I sip wine and play guitar with my amigos. I have a full and busy life. The American scoffed. I am a Harvard MBA and could help you. You should spend more time fishing and with the proceeds, buy a bigger boat. With the proceeds from the bigger boat, you could buy several boats. Eventually, you would have a fleet of fishing boats. Instead of selling your catch to a middleman, you would sell directly to the processor, eventually opening your own cannery. You would control the product, processing, and distribution. You would need to leave this small coastal village and move to Mexico City, then LA, and eventually New York City, where you will run your expanding enterprise. But how long will all this take? To which the American replied, 15 to 20 years. What then? Well, that's the best part. When the time is right, you would announce an IPO, sell your company stock to the public, and become very rich, make millions. Then what? Then you would retire, move to a small coastal fishing village where you would sleep late, fish a little, play with your kids, take siestas with your wife, stroll to the village in the evenings where you could sip wine and play guitar with your amigos.
There you go.
Thank you for laughing. So for me, this story is really about remembering what's important. What are you doing and why are you doing it? And I think we often get kind of caught up in, we have to do the things, we have to get more stuff, we have to keep doing everything. And we don't really ask, what do we actually want? And sometimes what we actually want is closer to what we're doing than what we think we should want or what we think we should be doing. And then, you know, it's just after New Year's. It's a little later than it was when I was supposed to do this. And we make all these big resolutions and we're like, yeah, we're gonna do stuff and we're gonna change. And by now, most of you, if you've made resolutions, are probably done with them. And that's kind of a shame. And it's sort of a shame to me that we only think about this once a year, that we only think of changing ourselves and making changes in our lives at the new year instead of doing it kind of all the time. And I really wish that everyone would take a few minutes and just think about what you actually want. What do you want to do, and what can you do to make your life more closely aligned with the things that you actually want? And then write it down. And then read it. Maybe every day. Maybe write it on your mirror in the bathroom. And share it with supportive people. I used to say share with everyone, but really, not everyone is going to be supportive of you. Some people will really, really not want you to change things. I'm pretty lucky most of the people in my life are either here or in my family are pretty supportive of all of my change. And then you have to make a plan. And making a plan is very hard. And taking the first step is very hard. And I'm going to back up a minute. So some of the stuff that's important to me, community. And I know a lot of you feel the same way because you come here and you do things and you get up here and talk and you play in the band and you plan hikes and you come to things. If you've ever talked to me, you've probably heard me talk about running. You've probably heard me talk about school. Those things are very important to me. One of the things I don't talk about a lot is that I'm saving for an early retirement. I plan to retire when I'm 50. I save a lot of money to that end out of my salary and my 401k every month. So taking the first steps. Sometimes you know what you want to do, and you really don't know what to do. How do you start saving for your retirement? How do you start going back to nursing school? How do you start a community? I don't know how you start a community. I got really lucky. Sunday Assembly was starting right when I moved here. And I was like, hey, that sounds really cool, and I just showed up. And I kept showing up. And when people said, we need someone to do these things, and I said, I can do one of those things, very small thing. And here we all are. It's wonderful. And running was something that I struggled with a lot. I really wanted to run, and I had a really hard time on my own learning to run and consistently running. And I found Fleet Feet here in Carborough, and I paid them some money. And for some reason, paying the money means that I will actually show up. And then I made friends. And so now if I don't show up, not only did I lose my money, but my friends call me and they're like, why weren't you here? Why aren't you running? What's going on? And those things work really well for me. So sometimes it's about finding not only what you want to do and taking a step, but finding the things that will work for you to do them. The first step is always often the hardest step. You have to go outside your comfort zone. Standing up here speaking is still really kind of terrifying.
You're doing great.
Thank you. And so this is the map. This is what people think it looks like, and that's what it actually probably looks like. It is not linear. It is, you take a step and then something happens and maybe you go way over here and sometimes you go backwards. I like to play the game, what's the worst thing that could happen? You fall down, you break your face, everyone laughs at you, it's terrible. First of all, that's never actually happened to me. A lot of cords up here, so there's some time. But you know, even if the absolute worst thing happens, death and destruction, everyone hates you, everyone laughs at you, no one ever talks to you again, maybe you have to move. It really isn't probably going to be that bad. We've survived everything that's happened to us so far. Chances are you're going to survive whatever happens to you next. And even if things go really, really badly, at least you will have learned something. And maybe it helps you figure out the next step to take. And so I encourage you all to make a plan and then take a step, even if it's a really, really small step. Because you're going to mess up. That's okay. And thank you, Kevin, for including my do everything in the intro. This is from Hyperbole and a Half. And this is, if you ever read the comic, she's do all the things and then sort of, because you can't do everything. You will burn out. It is terrible. Don't try. You have to pick a couple of things. What's really important to you? What really matters to you? And focus on that. One thing, two things, three things, maybe four things. More than four things, it's probably not a good thing. So we all have limited time, we all have limited money, and this is also part of don't try to do everything. I made an effort about 5 years ago to start living my life more in line with the things that I really valued. That involved selling my house in Connecticut, moving back home to be closer to my family, rearranging my schedule at work so that I could go back to school because I want my job to be more meaningful, which is why I want to go to nursing school. I like my job now for the most part, but I don't matter to the world in what I do at work. I matter to my job at what I do at work, but not to the world, and I wanted to change that. That was a lot of really big changes. But it didn't happen overnight. It took a long time to get here. Oh, yeah. So limited time. You have to pick. Do the things that are important to you. That is all. Thank you.
Music 10.
Thank you.
together.
You guys are great. We didn't have to ask you to stand up. Nice job, everybody. Small victories.
If you ever find yourself stuck in the middle of the sea, I'll sail the world to find you. If you ever find yourself lost in the dark and you can't see, I'll be the light to guide you. Find out what we're made of when we are called to help our friends in need. You can count on
some time together in silence, close your eyes if you want to, and think about how connected we are and how we can strengthen those connections.
Lots of stuff going on in our community this month, and I'm so excited.
So first, I'm going to tell you mine because I'm up here and I can. And I was going to do it in January, and we didn't get to come in January. So I have found my very favoriteest hobby in the whole wide world. And I started a podcast in January, and I'm just so excited about it. I keep telling everybody, you have to listen to my podcast. So popcultureleadsproject.com, you guys. It's called Pop Culturally Deprived, and you can find it on iTunes, or my website is popculturallydeprived.com. Self-plug. Randy's son had successful ear surgery. I'm not sure who wrote this. I think maybe Jax did. Nana and Pop Pop recently celebrated their 50th anniversary. Francesca has a birthday this week. She's turning 8. Happy birthday, Francesca. Devin also has a birthday coming up. He will be 18 on the 24th. Happy birthday. Sarah says, I'm not sure which Sarah. We have a lot of Sarahs, you guys. I am so, so happy H Mart came to Cary. It's a giant Korean grocery store and reminds me of home in Illinois. Sarah Rogers is back, you guys. Yay! And she's not even out here. She's hiding back there. There she is. Okay, so Reed's dad, Ray Guthrie, was diagnosed with leukemia recently. Treatment is a struggle, but the whole family is pitching in to help. Nicole's grandfather passed away last week. So I'm sorry. And Russell's dog, Colby, is very ill. I should have ended on a happy one, you guys. I'm sorry. Totally my bad. Yeah, listen to my podcast, you guys. Give me, like, more ego. I need it. So I'm going to go off script just a little bit. So we missed our second anniversary in January. That was our birthday. And we were going to do something then that we didn't get to do, so we're doing it now. And I don't know about you guys, but community is super important to me. And I lost community for a really, really long time until Sunday Assembly started. And there are two people who have made Sunday Assembly happen. We would not be here today without all of the hard work that they have put in. And so I would like Kevin and Heather to please come up here. Please. The amount of work that these two have put in. I mean, the rest of us volunteer, we come up here and we stand up here and we sing and we talk, but these guys make sure that we have a venue. They make sure that we have songs. They make sure we have speakers. They do everything. And I can't believe they haven't burned out yet, but if it wasn't for these two, none of us would be here today. And so we wanted to take a minute and give them this trophy. It says, Kevin and Heather Klein, rock stars of Sunday Assembly, Chapel Hill. So, and we also have a card for everybody that is able to, go eat and just have fun and have a date night and just relax because you guys deserve it. So you guys give Kevin and Heather two rounds of applause. Thanks, you guys. So, we've got several community events coming up, and I love these because Kevin and I don't run them. These are run by other folks who have interests and keep things going for us, which is fantastic. So thank you guys so much. I have to talk and, whew, all right, can do this. So we are going to hike at Bobbitt's Hole Trail at Indian River State Park. What's the date for that, Kate? I know we just set a date.
Yeah, March 5th.
It is up there. Okay, yeah. Awesome. March 5th. Fantastic.
It'll be afternoon rather than morning.
Yes. So there's a couple different trail options depending on the weather and the makeup of our group. Some are fairly level, some are a little steeper.
We'll hike rain or shine. Kids and leash dogs are welcome. A couple weeks ago, we accidentally hiked a different Eno River Trail because we had a little bit of an address mishap on the meetup, but now we're actually going to do Bobbitt's Hole, which is a super fun trail. I've done that trail before. So if you want more details, we do all of our signups on Meetup and Facebook. You can also talk to Kate. Kate will raise her hand. Kate's our hiking expert who runs these, so we would love to see you there. We had a lot of fun at the last one. Another sort of new activity we've got going that Randy is the volunteer facilitator for. Randy, would you raise your hand? So Randy is running our conversation group. So we're gonna have a second monthly meeting of our conversation group. This is gonna be Wednesday the 22nd at the Chapel Hill Public Library. So this group provides an opportunity to talk to and learn from other assembly members in a supportive and non-judgmental environment. At our last meeting, we sort of brainstormed some topics and some things that we wanted to talk about. So for this month, we're gonna focus on conversation starter. What are ways of thinking about ethical questions that are available to me beyond traditional religious moral structure? So no one in this group really has the answer. The idea is we'll all sort of get together and talk about what we know, maybe bring some books or some videos or some other interesting things you've learned from, and Randy will help facilitate that process. So thank you, Randy. On Sunday the 26th, so the last Sunday of this month, there's gonna be a board game afternoon at Jill's house. This is an all ages event. Kids need to be accompanied by a parent or guardian, but please feel free to bring along any games or snacks you want to share, and you can talk to Jill. Jill, there's Jill. You can talk to Jill. We'll be at her house. If you want more details, that's also up on Meetup. And then finally, we have a family-friendly volunteer day coming up. So Saturday, April 1st, we're going to be volunteering again at the North Carolina Diaper Bank, which collects donations of diapers and wipes and distributes them to shelters, food banks, and women's health centers across North Carolina. This is a really fun, sort of low-stress volunteer opportunity to get to know folks and package up some diapers. You can talk to Sylvia. Sylvia put this together if you have any questions, and you can also sign up online.
That is all ages. They have a kids play area for the under twos.
Yeah, we love the diaper bank because you can bring the whole family in. Yeah, they've got that little play space. So for the March assembly, we're going to be collecting diapers to bring over to the diaper bank. So diapers of any size, opened or not, diapers or wipes, if you want to bring them, we'll bring them with us to our diaper bank volunteer day.
They also collect feminine hygiene supplies.
Yes, feminine hygiene supplies as well. So if you'd like to bring those, all of those are very, very welcome in the places that the diaper bank distributes. So if none of those events interest you, and we would love to hear your suggestions, we would really love you to volunteer to lead an activity. So you can talk to an organizing team member, so anybody with the green lanyard is an organizing team member and can help you. We want to hear more voices up here. The hosting, like what I did today, anyone can do that. We've got it pretty scripted out. We do readings. The moment of science that Jake did, anyone can do that if you have a really interesting science thing you want to share. We're looking to book speakers starting from June on for this year. And the best way that we've found to find speakers, other than folks within our community, is people you know who can give a 20-minute talk on something of interest. So generally the themes are around live better, help often, or wonder more. So those are pretty broad. But we would love to hear your ideas for speakers or if you want to help put us in touch. And you can talk to me during snack time. I would love to hear any ideas you might have. Just a reminder that we run entirely on donations. There are a couple different ways you can donate to Sunday Assembly. These go towards our venue rental, printing, and things like that. We accept PayPal here through our website. You can sign up to be a sustainer, which a lot of folks do. We really appreciate it because you know, $5 or $10 through PayPal every month lets us know that we have an amount of money that we can always work with. So it's really helpful. And all donations are tax deductible because we are a 501c3. All right, our next assembly is right here on March 12th. Our speakers will be Renee and Bert Rauch from PFLAG in the Triangle. P PFLAG is Parents and Friends of Lesbians and Gays. It's an advocacy group that provides education, resources, and solidarity to gay, queer, and trans youth and their families. So Renee and Bert will be speaking about PFLAG's mission and their own personal experience in growing into being more accepting people. So just a little final quote before our last song, and then it's snack time, and there are chocolate-covered strawberries back there that someone made those for us today. You guys are amazing. Thank you. So exciting. So something to consider as you set goals in the coming days and weeks and months. A quote I really like from Brené Brown. What would you be glad you did even if you failed? That and a last song.
Bright, 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 sunshiny day. Yes. Yeah.